It's good seeing you guys. Listen, I need you to grab a Bible if you've got one. We're going to be Matthew chapter 5 in the next little bit here. Matthew chapter 5, verse 1 to 12. If you are new here, my name is Jeff Bucknam. I have the privilege of being one of the pastors, get to preach and teach in this little corner of God's kingdom. And we're going to have a good time, I think, in the next little bit here on Matthew chapter 5. I have a bad hip. And I've had it for 3 years. I went to the chiropractor yesterday because the physical therapist didn't work, and the other two doctors I saw looked at it and said, you need an x-ray. So I got an x-ray, and they were like, you need another x-ray. So I got another x-ray, and they were like, these x-rays don't tell us anything. So eventually, you know, once you get through with the real doctors, you go to the chiropractor, and anyway, Britt Gilman, his wife, is the chiropractor, and she jumped on top of me and made everything crack. Because I've had so much difficulty trying to figure out what's wrong with me, you know, you end up playing, you know, your own doctor for a minute or two there, and this is what WebMD exists for. Is so you could be your own doctor. And so you get on there and you list your symptoms, or you look at the body and you think, okay, if it hurts there, here's the stuff that's around there, and then you start Googling that different stuff. I eventually got to the point where I realized it was a sacroiliac joint pain. Some of you are doctors in the room, you're like, yeah, that's it. I'd never heard of that. I didn't know we had one. Sacroiliac joint pain, and there was a list of like six different things, and you know, this is what you do. You say number one, do I have that? Yep, I got that. Two, yeah, huh? Three, four, and you tick the box next to it, or you make the box next to it, and you think it's got to be it, right? Because I've got these different things. The problem, of course, in WebMD is that you know when you go to the cancer page, it's everything. So you're like, oh, we all have cancers. What's going on. The idea, though, of a diagnosis based upon certain traits is something that's actually not alien to Scripture. This text, Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 12, is actually a really useful passage. This is what most of you, if you've been in the church at all, you know that these are called the Beatitudes. Beatitude is that comes from the Latin word meaning blessed. And they all start with, blessed are these kinds of people. Blessed are, blessed are, blessed are, blessed are, blessed are. This is the first speech, basically, that Jesus gives to his disciples, the whole crowd of disciples, as they're following Jesus in Matthew's gospel. And so this is what we call the Sermon on the Mount, the beginning of it. He lays out, basically, this is what it's going to look like for you to follow me. In this life, these are the kinds of traits that need to be yours if you want to look like a genuine follower of mine. So if you're ever wondered, hey, I wonder if I'm a real follower of Jesus, or maybe you've not wondered that, but I'm going to give you a list of 8 traits that is in this text, and you should in your mind be ticking off next to it saying, uh-huh, true, uh-huh, true, uh-huh, true. If you get to a point in it, though, that you're like, not so much. The text itself is intended to make you wonder, ooh, is it my sacroiliac joint? Am I a real Christian? So look, it's a great passage of Scripture. I want to start just in verse 1 here. At Matthew chapter 5. Verse 1, what kinds of traits does a genuine follower of Jesus have? I told you that there are 8 of them. So here's the first of them. They are poor in spirit. So here's the setting of the passage, though. Okay, so seeing the crowds, a lot of Jesus' ministry could just be titled crowded. Yeah, which, of course, makes sense. If you met some guy who was doing miracles, and was calling people to come and follow him after they had been healed, or maybe you've been longing for, you know, the Messiah in that setting to come, and all of a sudden this guy comes along and he starts doing miracles like he's God, You might stop what you're doing and thinking, all right, this is the dude. And you pick everything up and you start following him. And so he's traveled all around the Galilee, the lake. He's traveled all around the region, picking up people as he goes. People who are convinced that this is the Messiah. This guy's going to be the one who's going to deliver us from the strong arm of the Romans. And so they follow him and follow him. And so Jesus notices that the crowd is getting quite large. And when he does, he went up on the mountain. Now, where I'm from, mountains are huge, like rocky mountains, cascade. Like you can drive up into the mountains and see the jagged peaks. That's not the mountain. People here in the Midwest, we're probably closer to understanding this than people maybe on the West Coast would, because for us, mountains are just little bumps, right? Did you know that there's a hill? I think it was an old trash hill by O'Hare. If you're driving on 90, and on the right hand side, you all know it because my family, we call it Mount Illinois, right? Because we always know you're near O'Hare because we're like, hey, Mount Illinois, right? That's kind of what it was like. Here's actually a picture of what the mountains looked like in those days. So you got the Sea of Galilee down here, and to come up to the mountains, to come from the sea up this hill, Luke's gospel, when it describes this this event, this Sermon on the Mount, it actually says that he got to a level place. So we're talking about like a plateau in the middle of the hills above the lake. He went up on the mountain, the hill, Mount Illinois, and when he sat down, this is how they preached in those days, or how they taught in those days, okay? Different than us. Right here, you get to sit, I have to stand. There, you sit down, and the disciples would gather, and some in the front would sit down, and the others would be standing around in the back. Way better for me in my back. We should have tried this today. When he sat down, his disciples came to him. The people who were genuinely following him were the ones that he wanted to speak to. He wanted to make clear to them what they were getting into here. Like, if you're going to be part of the kingdom that is coming and already here, the kingdom of heaven is what he's going to call it. If you're going to be part of this thing, these are the marks that ought to be in your life. These are the things that will show you and everybody else that you are a kingdom of heaven man. So the disciples come to him and they gather around him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed. That word means congratulations are due to. You know, when somebody has a baby, congratulations. Somebody, you know, they win the spelling bee, congratulations. When somebody finishes college, congratulations. Congratulations are due to. We should look up at, we should consider highly those who are the things that will follow. They are blessed. They should be the people in the highest estimation in our thinking. Dude, I got to tell you just ahead of time, can I just pause here a minute? When we get into this, the first thing you're going to notice is like everything he says is blessed. You and I are going to be like, what? That none of that, what? Are you crazy? Where do you live? And the answer is the kingdom of heaven. All right, we'll play the sermon. Here we go. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Luke, when you go to his gospel, he just says, blessed are the poor. And there's like a kind of overlap in that. So if you take those two together, what you've got is there's a subset of the poor in spirit who are just poor, right? And then there's the poor in spirit. And the reason that Matthew wants to use this wider group is he's saying, yeah, people who don't have any money are blessed. But it's not just money. It's when you don't have the resources necessary to make things go for you. When you recognize that you're empty, that there's, you just don't have it all together, those people, says Jesus, are blessed. In fact, that is a sign that they're members of my kingdom. We should congratulate those people who don't have a clue how they're going to make it work tomorrow. We should lift up highly and honor and desire to be like those who suck at life. Amen? Okay, so wait a minute. Wait a minute. To be a follower of Jesus, you need to know you need him. You're not going to follow if you don't think you need him. You might follow for a minute for the show, right? I mean, especially these folks. I want to see some healings. I want to see some miracles. But if you don't think you need him, yeah, it gets old real quick, especially when he starts demanding stuff from you. Or he starts saying crazy things like this. Like, you need to know deep in your spirit that without him, without what he's going to provide, without the direction, the safety, the financial care, without him providing my daily bread, without him taking care of that, I and everyone I care for are lost. Which is weird for us, right? Because you know this, when your wife goes out to buy things at Hobby Lobby, right? Well, she's gone for a while. I don't know what happens in Hobby Lobby. There's something going on in there. It's probably a witch's coven or something, but there's something going on in Hobby Lobby, but men aren't allowed to go in there. So you go into Hobby Lobby, or I don't, she does. She comes back. They must have like a billion little framed things that say thankful on them, right? Or blessed. I have a blessed sign in my house. I have a thankful sign in my house. She got one that said grace on it too. Do you know what's interesting? I don't know how I would feel if I walked into a very poor person's house. In some of the places I've been in the world, if I went to like Fiji, and I walked into the house of some of the people I've met and know there who barely have anything, and if they had a little, you know, Hobby Lobby sign that said blessed, I would probably be like, really? Listen, it makes sense for us here to be blessed, right? We have extra cars, we've got TV. I'm like, our blessed stuff and our thankful thing is right next to our 60-inch TV, right? Because we're blessed. It's okay to have a 60-inch TV. But we're blessed. That's the way we think about it, right? The more stuff you have, the more blessed you are. The more success you experience, the more blessed you are. If we were going to draw a picture of the blessed man in the Western world, we would say, first of all, he's massively respected for his success. He's got sort of the Midas touch when it comes to business. He knows what to invest in. He knows what not to invest in. He's done all the credentials he's learned, whether in school or through the school of hard knocks, how to make it work. Super, super successful. He also drives the right car. And for different ones of us, the right car is like a Ford truck. And for other people, it's a Lamborghini. Or for me, a Honda. No? But he drives the right car. And for most of us, it's usually some little coupe. It's usually some fantastic thing that when he drives by, we're like, that is a nice car. He's got six-pack abs. He doesn't have them. I got a one-pack. He doesn't have this. He's got five more. He usually skips leg day, right? Huge pipes. Right, a little tiny, but he swills brandy, smokes a cigar. No, there's nothing wrong with that. But this is the picture, isn't it? Sits in a cushy leather chair with his rich mahogany behind him. This is what it means to be a success. Women fawn over him. Even if he's gotten older, he grows a beard, and it's checker, it's, you know, salt and pepper beard, and he's the most interesting man in the world. But this is the image that we have. And all of the things that I just described are basically he's cool. Everything he does is cool. He's totally blessed, this guy. We should congratulate this guy. Jesus is like, no, no. Blessed is the opposite of that. Blessed is the dude who looks in the mirror and doesn't want to look in the mirror anymore. Blessed is the guy who hasn't figured it out at all. Blessed is the guy who feels like he's totally in over his head, that most of his life is spent trying to gasp for air, knowing that if Jesus isn't there, if he's not held up by a sovereign God, we're all done. Jesus basically says the cool kids aren't truly blessed. It's the ones who don't have it together at all. Because the needy see their need for Jesus. So it's blessed to be needy. I've shared this with lots and lots of people, and I've gotten to the point where I'm very happy to speak about it. I have fought depression my whole life. I didn't know that. I first fought it when I was in college. I don't really know why. I went to the University of Washington thinking it was going to be the greatest experience by freshman year, but I went into the deepest, darkest hole. I remember laying on the floor of my dorm room, praying, feeling like I just wanted to sink into the floor and into the foundations of the building so that no one could see me. I used to get in my car late at night. I couldn't sleep. I'd get in my car late at night, and I'd just drive for hours, just drive. End up in the mountains sometimes. Sat down in 8K, pie at a 24-hour place on Snoqualmie Pass. Total loser. The waitress is looking at me like, do you have friends? Nah, I don't have any. I don't know. Subsided a little bit as time went on, but I moved to New Zealand. And then after 2 years, moved back thinking it was time to go and settle down in the United States and find a job. I applied 70 different churches, and like two of them were interested in talking to me. And when I went and visited them, they would say really, really mean things. I mean, one of them actually was in here in Chicago. It's not Harvest, thank you. But it was here in Chicago. And I remember going out to dinner with this couple, and they you know what they said? They said, so you're not in ministry right now. I said, no, I actually was in ministry in New Zealand. I had come back, and they said, well, we don't want any losers leading our church. You know, we don't want somebody who needs the role. We want somebody who's like proven and able to do the stuff. And my wife is sitting next to me. They just went on and on and on about this. My wife's sitting next to me. And my sweet wife, Jeannie, who would never contradict anyone, she was right in there saying, who do you think you are? I was like, you go, girl, right? But I couldn't speak. Seriously, I couldn't speak because, you know, I was sitting there trying to hold it together. I was shaking. Tears were welling up in my eyes. They're right. I'm a total loser. Don't want to get up in the morning. You just lay there in your bed because there's no point. And it's not that you want to kill yourself so much as I just wish I never was even made. Lord, you made a horrible mistake. There's a man who could leave my family better. There is a son who could treat his parents better. Everything I touch is just... My mom died 2011, November 11th, 2011 at 11 a.m. in the morning. And that sent me into... I was the only one sitting there all night long with her. My dad took off. God bless him. He was so overwhelmed with sorrow, he just couldn't be there. My sisters left, and I was the one who sat there and held my mom's hand as she died, and she was breathing, like she was choking to death on her own phlegm all night long. And then she'd stop, and I'd think, this is it. And then she'd keep going. It was the worst night of my entire life. She died the next morning when I had gone away to take a shower and came back, and she was dead. I kissed her cold head. And from that day to this, man, there's something I can't replace. I've had to face some of the worst ministry experiences. And I always thought, okay, I'm going to go into this and I'm going to make a difference and stuff. And it goes haywire. Everything goes haywire. And you're left thinking, Lord, what? I don't. I can't get it together. You know, when I share that with people, oh, you'd be shocked, especially men. After church services and stuff, they sidle up to me real quietly. I'll be in the corner. In fact, they'll come up, look around. Hey, I feel like that. I'm on medication. So when they say that, I say, have you seen a doctor? And they'll be like, well, no, my wife wants to be. Yeah, go see a doctor, man. It took me forever to see a doctor. I was a jerk to my wife and family a long time. And then I saw a doctor and it helped a little bit. Didn't kill it. Still there. And here's the crazy part, though. What I should be saying to that guy is, oh, you suffer that? You are blessed. Because if there's one thing that I've learned in all the depression, it's that I need Jesus. I have nothing without Jesus. And he should have passed me by. I should not be here. He should have passed me by. He had every right to. He didn't look down and say, Jeff, if you're on my team, we're going to win. Instead, he came by and he said, no, I'll have that one. For the foundations of the world, he said, I'll have that one. Because the less I'm able to do, the more cracks in the pot, the greater the light shines, right? Nobody's ever going to come up to me and say to me, you know, you're really great. And me think, you're right. I'm going to say, you have no idea how not great I am. Any great is because of Christ. That's it. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. You want a sign that you're a citizen of the kingdom of heaven? Do you know you don't have it together? Do you know that you're a failure? It's like an entry requirement. Jesus, Peter, whatever, you just stand at the gates, pearly gates. Hi there. How'd you do? Terrible. Welcome in. Blessed are the poor in spirit. There's eight of them, two. Blessed are those who, look at it, who mourn. Those who have lost something or someone that they cared so much about that they can't see past it. Those who want to be distracted in their minds to something else all the time, because if they're not distracted by the game, by the sports, by the book, by the work, they come right back to it and their hearts are grieving over the loss of that thing. It could have been a dream that they had. It could have been the loss of a financial success. It might have been loss of a spouse. It might have been whether that loss of the spouse happened through divorce or through death. Just overwhelming. Can you imagine somebody coming up to you while you're mourning and saying, well, you're blessed. Congratulations. Why would anyone do that? Of course the answer is, listen, the moment that you know that life is temporary, the moment that you recognize that death is right there and it will come for all of us, the more you start thinking, huh, I should do something about what my state of my soul is for that moment. I should probably be prepared for what might happen afterward. So the one who mourns knows that the world is unfair. It's going to beat the living daylight out of them. And they turn to God because they have no answers for those days. So pastor, actually, story I heard about a pastor who was living next door to a guy who was like really committed to not being a Christian. So the pastor would come home from work and the guy who was doing his leaves or whatever would come over to the fence and be like, "Hey, how's it going? You know what? You know what I did last night? I cheated on my wife. You know what I did last night?" And then he'd list off all sorts of horrible things. "How you feel about that? How you feel about that?" And anyway, he did this. He kept mocking him and saying all sorts of stuff over years. Finally, the guy came over and started talking about his latest exploits with other women. And the pastor turned to him and said, he said, "What do you think about that?" He said, "You know what? I hope you keep doing it." And the guy was like, "What? What kind of pastor are you?" He said, "I'll tell you what kind of pastor I am, because here's the thing. If you keep cheating on your wife, I'm hoping that at some point she finds out. And when she finds out, she'll kick you out. And when she kicks you out, you're going to find yourself in a one-bedroom studio apartment because you're the one who's wronged her. You won't be able to see your kids for a very long time. And you're going to sit there above that studio apartment. And at that moment, finally, you will start thinking about how this ends. If everything goes well for you, you will never have to face your need for God. But if it doesn't, there's hope. So blessed are you who mourn." It's opened your eyes to what might be. You've been pulled away from all the distractions, and now you're focused on the end. Third one, blessed are the meek. This is a word we don't use very often. The word actually means powerless. It's the opposite of powerful. It's the person who is oppressed. It's the prisoner. They're blessed. You know, we long for power to control our surroundings. And we certainly don't see the lowly and powerless as blessed. They're blessed because they will inherit the earth. They will basically, this is so crazy, the powerless will end up having power in the new heavens and new earth. Total flip. So if you're meek, you're blessed because you recognize, again, that you have need. You know that you're the object of others' scorn, and that turns your attention to what you don't have. There's a hunger and a thirst, which we'll get to in a second. I had a friend who actually had a cabin in Canada. It's a holiday house, I guess. It's on the other side of a lake, beautiful lake in British Columbia, and it's the only thing on that side. Behind it was like 6,000 acres of forest. There's nothing behind it except bears and cougars. So, but it was right on the lake, and he had built this cabin over there, and the only way that you could get to it is if you drive on the main road on the opposite side of the lake and you'd honk your horn. And then he would look out, and he would get on his little pontoon boat, and he'd ride across and pick up you with all your stuff. And then you'd go park your car on the opposite side, leave it there for an hour long, you're going to be there, and he'd go back to the other side with you. And it was like Alcatraz for me, right? Like we are actually stuck here, and he would never let me drive his boat. I don't know why. I think he wanted me to feel the pain. This is what it's like, Jeff, to be in prison your whole life. We would have bears that would show up. I remember one night was sleeping out in a tent on their lawn, which is stupid. And my friend Trevor was, he and his wife were in the next tent. He's a cop. Then my friend Nate and his wife were on the next tent, and he's about 6'6", about 320, big, big dude. And the middle of the night, I heard something rustling outside, and I got out, and there's a bear, like, right there, drinking from the lake. And so I'm going next door to my Trevor, who brought his cop shotgun with him. Come on, get out here. And he never comes. Nate comes first. What's going on? And he gets close to the bear. Well, it's a bear. Yeah, it's a bear, man. It's a bear. He came to eat us. Trevor finally comes out. What's wrong? Get your gun. Scared me half to death. I didn't want to sleep there one more moment, but I couldn't leave. I tried to swim across the lake. No joke. Swim to see if I could do it. Could I possibly get free? This language that's used, I bring all that up because blessed are the meek. When it says powerless, a lot of the language from this passage comes from Isaiah 61, where Jesus said, I came to preach good news to the poor, freedom of sight to the blind, and to set free the captive. Most scholars think this is what he's talking about, that blessed are the captives. Blessed are the ones who are under the thumb of others, because it makes them long for something else. It makes them realize that this life is not going to provide for them what they want. They don't have the power to change their circumstances. And when you're thwarted in wanting to change your circumstances, it makes you think, man, if I need someone who can deliver for me, because I can't do it myself. Don't you see? It's the presence of need. So blessed are the meek. Fourth, blessed are those who, here's the language, hunger and thirst for righteousness. Hunger and thirst. The language is, when you're hungry or thirsty, it's because you have a lack of food or drink. You're yearning inside. You're yearning for something. It's when your kids come home and they're like, I'm starving. Well, you're not starving, but what's going, if you ask them, what's going on inside of you? I have this deep urge and yearning to have something to fill the emptiness. Right, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, meaning rightness, right living, justice, both in themselves and in the world around. You long for a state of righteousness, to be able to look at yourself and say, I don't make all the wrong decisions. I don't turn to sin when I shouldn't be. And in the world, the people treat each other well. The only people who hunger and thirst for righteousness are the ones who are for justice are the ones who are experiencing injustice, right? And they're blessed. If you're experiencing injustice, if somebody's got their thumb on you, if they're treating you with disregard, you're blessed, says Paul. Sorry, it says Jesus, 2 Timothy 4, 6 to 8. This is a really fascinating little text. 2 Timothy 4, 6 to 8 is the end of Paul's life. These are the last words he basically says, for I'm already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I fought the good fight. You hear it? I'm about to die. I fought the good fight, finished the race. I've kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day, the day of the Lord, when he returns. And he's not only going to reward me, he's not only going to give me this crown of righteousness, but he's also going to give it to all who have, notice the language, loved his appearing. When I was a kid, I remember thinking to myself, when I first came to faith in Christ and I started thinking about the return of Christ, I was like, man, I'm like 16 years old. There's so much of life I want to live. Before Jesus comes back, man, I hope he waits. The longer that you live, the less you feel that way. And the reason is because the longer you live, the more injustice you see. The more you feel injustice, and the more just deep in your soul, you're like, you've got to make it right. You have to make it all right. That yearning, that desire that wells up inside of us, that is a sign that you're his. That one day he will descend from the clouds and he will make everything sad come untrue. The yearning for that day and for the fact that he's going to come and bring judgment and justice on all those who have wronged and gotten away with it. The people who, were able to hide all their wickedness They didn't hide it from him. And on that day, he will bring judgment and all will be made right. And I will be freed from my compulsions to do the things that are unjust and not right. The longing for that is a sign that you're a Christian. If you don't have that longing, if you're like, I don't want to stay here, you don't love his appearing. And if you don't love his appearing, I don't know, man. It's like a big deal. Big sign that you're a real Christian. All right, number five. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. This is an interesting little text. The idea that a true Christian is merciful means that they refrain from seeking retribution upon another. They can get it, but they choose not to. This is so backwards. We would think, no, blessed are the ones who get the vengeance, right? Have you guys seen Equalizer yet? Have you seen The Equalizer? Denzel Washington? Oh, come on. Right? There's a point in the movie that you're like, oh, here it comes. That's right. You know what I'm here for? I'm here for some Denzel Washington justice. And when he brings it, you're like, oh, come on, a little bit more, right? We love, end of the movie, you walk out feeling a kind of satisfaction, right? Because the wickedness was dealt with. It was equalized, right? It's a great movie. Movie Taken. Do you remember Taken? I have a particular set of skills, right? Take my daughter, I take your head. Most of our movies are justice films. Most of the movies guys like, the shoot 'em ups, they're always justice films. I remember sitting in a theater, though, for a couple of different movies that ended very differently, and the response of the people in the theater were really weird. There's a movie called Gran Turismo, Gran Turismo? Anyway, doesn't matter. Clint Eastwood was in it. At the end, Gran Torino. One is a car, yeah. The other's a video game. Anyway, he goes out, he at the end of the movie, he gets all sidled up with all the, it's Clint Eastwood, right? Dirty Harry. You're like, oh, here it comes. He goes out to shoot up the house with all the kids in it. But instead of shooting it up, he stands out there and he does this. And he gets shot. And the end scene is him laying on the ground with in a posture like Jesus. And that's the end of the movie. The dude sitting next to me, when I watched it, fade to black at the end of the film, he's like, what was that? What a Dirty Harry! He stood up and he looked like Dirty Harry, right? Right? We don't like, the people who don't get the justice should not be congratulated. They're not the ones we say, well, you're blessed. You never got closure on that. You never got justice on that. No Country for Old Men. Have you seen this movie? Most people hate it. Because the guy goes around shooting holes with air pump in everyone's head. And you're like, oh, dude, you're going to get it. When Lee Jones, he gets you, you're dead. Well, he never does. He never does. The last scene is Tommy Lee, who's been sitting, he's retired, and he said, hey, I had a dream last night, describes his dream, and fade to black. Again, I'm in the theater going, that was a great, great film. The guy in front of me is like, that's the worst ending ever. The guy got away, he did all that. Right. Because we want the vengeance. We don't want the mercy. We want it for me. We don't want to show it. But the crazy part is every person who's a Christian has been shown mercy of the greatest variety ever. Jesus goes on a cross, he receives the retribution on our behalf so that we might go free. Oh, mercy. So we receive mercy, but we don't want to show it. What does it say about us? Well, Jesus told a story. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle, one was brought to him who owed 10,000 talents. That's about $10,000 million. So figure that out. And since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. This is the way that they did it in those days. If you had a debt, you had to pay with your life, if not with your money. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of, same word, mercy, out of pity for him, the master of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But when that same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. Not the hugest debt. It's a debt. But not the hugest debt, especially compared to the one he was forgiven. And seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, pay what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? And I will pay you. He refused and went out, and he put him in prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. And then his master summoned him and said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave all that debt because you pleaded with me, and should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you. Will do what? Deliver you to the prison if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. You want a sign that you're a believer in the Lord Jesus, a genuine one, and not just playing the game? The people who have wronged you in your life, do you still want to get back at them? Do you entertain the rage fantasies while you're mowing your lawn or driving your car with the radio off? Are you committed to seeing their downfall and sometimes even working toward it? Maybe not with your actions, you know, going and punching them, but certainly with your words, you know, talking behind their back, creating false stories or half-true stories so that their reputation is ruined because they deserve it. Yeah, you deserved it too. So did I. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Number 6. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Notice the language. Pure in heart. Pure, of course, is mean morally upright. But here's the interesting part about this one. It's not just morally upright in terms of their action. It's morally upright in their heart. Meaning that the actions that they're doing, the moral, religious-y kind of actions that they're doing, are being driven from a heart that means it. There's a difference. Right, you can do all sorts of religious stuff and not have it come from the heart. There's whole churches in the world that are filled with people who are doing the religious stuff, but it doesn't come from the heart. This language actually comes from Psalms. Psalm 24, who shall ascend the hill of the Lord and who shall stand in his holy place? Who gets to see God? Well, he who has clean hands, right, and a what? It's not just the hands, guys. It's a pure heart, and who does not lift up his soul to what is false and doesn't swear deceitfully. It's what's going on inside. You know, because a lot of people, look, we treat God very much like he is, you know, a massive vending machine. The way that it's supposed to work with religion is you take the stuff, you take your good works and you plunk them into the vending machine, you hit B3 and out comes the Coke Zero. That's how it works. You get very angry. If you're committed to this way of thinking, what happens is when you start putting your good works in and this good stuff doesn't come out, you get very angry at the vending machine, don't you? So you get really mad at God because your life's not turning out the way you wanted it to. Because you say, look at all I've done for you, God. And what do you mean, what have you done for me? I go to church all the time and I give the money. I do lots of religious activities. Don't you see my clean hands? And he's like, yeah, but the pure heart. Can you imagine being married and just doing stuff for your spouse? Listen, here's the deal. I'm gonna live with you. I'm gonna hang out with you. I'll watch your movies. I'll, you know, mow the lawn. I'll even help with the dishes every once in a while, but don't expect me to feel anything about it. Don't expect me to love you. I can do the duties as long as you perform the duties that I'm expecting you to do in exchange. We're fine. Is this gonna work? No, absolutely not, because at some point she's gonna say, not enough. This isn't a business relationship. I want your heart. God wants your heart. My son plays baseball. You know what they do in the baseball, his baseball team, Louisiana State University? Before the game, they all gather around in a circle and they say the Lord's Prayer. I know the way these guys live. But here they are doing this religious thing, right? Isn't it crazy? Lord, look what we're doing right now. We deserve to win. We're saying the magic phrases that will get us the stuff. Everybody say it right. You remember the scene in Talladega Nights? The famous, you know, and the always delicious Taco Bell. You know, the Jesus prayer. There's a point at which his wife says to Ricky Bobby, she says, Ricky, I want you to say this grace good so God will let us win tomorrow. Right. It's just, it's a business transaction. Man, so many people, it's a business transaction. And they're like, yeah, but I'm pure. But are you pure in heart? Now, real Christians are pure in heart. They mean it. They actually mean it. Religion without this is a total waste of time. You guys know that, right? Sunday mornings, you could watch football. There's a lot of other things you can and should be doing. And I totally invite you to. You're not helping anybody if you're just posing. You're not. Nobody's helping anybody by just posing. Just be honest about it and decide, I'm not going to do that. I mean, you're going to miss out on eternal life, which is a problem. But don't pretend that God doesn't know, right? I don't know what number we're on. 7. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Sons of God, they will have a family resemblance to God. Who will? The peacemakers. The ones who don't seek warmongering, but peacemaking. They're the ones who will look for an opportunity to make nice. The ones who will figure out how they can, this is hard for me and for most men because I have a car, I bought a turbo. It's a Mazda, so it's not really that great, but it's a Mazda turbo. And when I bought it, I got the turbo because the guy told me, if you drive the turbo, you're not going to want to do the regular one. And I said, well, let me try the turbo. And he was right. I'm not going back because this thing is amazing. I can beat most cars off the line. And I have tried to do this. I live in Barrington, and so this road 59, you have to stop at several points along 59. And it's honestly like you come up to the front of the race line, right? And you do. And you look over, and you try to figure out, okay, we got to, you know, this over there. And, of course, in Barrington, they got all a bunch of people who've got these really swanky cars. And so I come up in my Mazda, and this guy in the BMW here, and the Audi over here, and they're all like, I'm going to beat you so we can win at Gulf Verges. We're going to do that. And I'm like, bam! I don't lose. And then I laugh because I'm like, Mazda, you know? It's a 1/5 of the cost of your car. Okay, one time, I was doing it, but I'm so used to doing it when my wife was in the car. And I started going, and this dude in this, I don't know what he had under the hood in this Honda Civic, but man, he was moving. And I beat him, but while we were coming to the end, I had come up on the back of another car, and so I had to slow down. And this dude pins right in next to me, so I can't get in. And I'm like, what are we doing? You gotta let me in. And he's just looking at me, shaking his head. No, you're not coming in. You would think somebody who is a pastor at this point would say to themselves, blessed are the peacemakers. But I'm like, oh, not today, right? So, no kidding. Down 59, going south, side by side. He's in the middle of the road, I'm on the edge of the road, and I'm like, I'm not giving in. And my wife is losing her mind. What are you screaming? She was probably right. There's something about it, though, in my heart. I don't want to lose. I don't want to lose. I'm a winner. Winners, we congratulate the winners. We congratulate the people who win the debate. We congratulate the guy who's able to succeed while the other person fails. And then we congratulate him even more if when he succeeds, he goes to the guy who fails and says, Mazda, right? The whole world would tell you that. And yet Jesus is like, no, blessed are the peacemakers. Let me give you a piece of advice. When I was young in my marriage, I thought that I could win my wife's mind to reason through argumentation. And I'm good at it. And so I would debate her and win the debate every time. And I was always shocked that this wasn't solving the issue. So, but no joking, as I got older, I started to realize that there is a way of peacemaking. Every time I've been in a disagreement with my wife, I have done something wrong. And that's the truth. We would not be in the argument had I not, whether started it or responded in a way I should not have done so. And I have found that every time I've come to her and said to her, here's where I was wrong, peace ensues. But that kind of humility, that kind of acknowledgement that I don't always get it right, is so uncommon these days. But there, it's a sign that you're a Christian. Peacemaking. Last one. Praise God. Blessed are those who are persecuted. No. Right? What are you talking about? Blessed are those who are persecuted. Yeah, the ones who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Remember righteousness? Right living, justice, living justly. Blessed are those who, when you live justly, you get mocked, beaten, scorned, lose your job, killed. Blessed are you, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you, persecute you, utter all kinds of evil against you. You know, those things that you hear from other people or through other people. I was talking to so-and-so who talked to so-and-so, and they hate your guts. Why? Well, because you acted this way. You told them to be quiet when we were out of the baseball game and they were yelling at the ump. And you said, don't do that to the ump. And so you're standing for justice and righteousness. And now they hate you. What? Yeah, blessed are you when you're talked about. Rejoice, in fact, and be glad for your reward. And we're not talking about extra credit rewards here. Your reward, the reward of heaven, is great. It's great in heaven. For they who persecuted the prophets who were before you. You guys, you know what this is essentially saying? It's saying that, look, when you are persecuted for doing right, when you live in a particular way at your workplace and you don't get along because normally at the workplace you overcharge and you're not going to do it. And they start saying, aren't you in it for the team? When you act lovingly and caringly, even when the demand is for you to act callously by your workplace. And everyone starts pushing against you, and they say, you're not going to get along. Those of you who are involved in education, and you start teaching the things that you know are not right. But you know that if you don't do it, they're going to lose their minds on you. And Jesus is like, yes, blessed are you, job losers. Blessed are you, the ones who are the object of scorn. The prophets, they did it to the prophets as well. In other words, look, the prophets are in heaven with God. If you want to know if you're on the right track with Jesus, if you genuinely want to know, if you're a genuine Christian, then a sign along the road is that the right people don't like you. Right, so how'd you do? Did you tick them off? Look, I gotta be honest with you. These are not saying blessed will be. They're saying blessed are. So if these things are not true of you, I'm concerned. If the marks of the sickness, if they don't point to you having Christianity, if you having the Jesus bug, so here's what I want to do. I just want you to pray with me, but I'm going to invite you in a prayer of repentance. And I don't really care where you are in your spiritual journey. You know, you might be a Christian. You might have thought yourself a Christian for all these years, and you might have just showed up today and never been a Christian at all. But I'm just going to tell you, I'm going to pray a prayer of repentance for you to pray, to say, Lord, form these in me. Make these real in me. I don't want to fake it anymore. So will you pray together with me? Father, I'm thankful for my friends. And I'm thankful, Father, that a passage like this has an ability to poke us. It's what it was intended to do with all these disciples, a crowd following Jesus. And here we are, a crowd gathered together in one of his churches. And we're reading his words. And the effect on us is probably the same effect that was had on them. I don't know if we're peacemakers, Lord. Most of us don't want to be poor in spirit. Our attitudes are so upside down, and we know you want to make them right side up. So, Lord, we ask you to forgive us for our failure to see the world through your eyes. We ask you to give us the mercy that you say you give. We haven't been merciful to others, Lord. We haven't. We want revenge. We avoid situations that will put us into bad mouthing and persecution, Lord. But I pray so much that you would make these things real in us. I pray for my brothers here particularly who have lived their lives in a way. They've ticked boxes with it comes to you. They do all the religious things, but their hearts aren't really with you. God, I pray that purity of hands that they think is going to be enough, Father, that you convince them tonight that it's not, that you want their heart. And so, Lord, we together, we just want to tell you that we love you, and we want to turn away from the ways that we have been, the things we have valued, and we want to turn toward you. You say that days of refreshing will come from the Lord when we do that. So I pray for days of refreshing. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So we've got one more song. There are going to be some guys around who would be happy to pray with you. Some of the pastors and stuff probably be up at the front afterwards. Listen, if you want to talk about any of this, there's a bunch of the pastors going to be up here. You can chat with them about it. They'd love to talk to you about all sorts of stuff. Remember, when you go this way and are saying basically publicly that I don't have it all together, now blessed are you.